In this CGA Celebrity Golf Series, we're going to meet two NFL stars. Greg Brazina went from All-American at the University of Houston to a 12-year career with the Atlanta Falcons, including a Pro Bowl appearance. And Derwin Gray, now a 6-year NFL veteran with the Colts and Panthers after an All-American college career. Now let's join CGA's director Mark Eberle as we turn NFL hitters into golfers.
Hello, welcome to another session of CGA Celebrity Golf Series. I'm Mark Eberle. I'm the director of the CGA. With me today, Greg Brazina, former Atlanta Falcons, and Derwin Gray, presently with the Panthers. Join us and we're going to work on Greg and Derwin's swing, and we're going to see what we can't get done today. Greg, we've been talking about the athletic move, okay?
Yes.
You can relate to that.
Yeah. Well, the athletic move is shifting your weight. And playing linebacker, I've always played on the balls of my feet because
ready to lunge
and to attack. And then what I'm finding and what you're coaching me in is to be able to relax and let the club do the work rather than me trying to control the club in the sense of attacking the ball.
Exactly. We make the same athletic move, but it's under control because we don't have to go anywhere to get anyone. We don't have to go hit people. The ball's right there. And therefore, we need to stay relaxed because it's right in front of us. We don't have to chase it down. We don't need all of that energy. What we need is control and balance. So what we're working on is the ability, just like both of you've always done in your football careers, is making the athletic move, that weight shift from one side, weight shift back through, okay?
Well, and one of the reasons it's so difficult for us in football is that when we make our shift move, the athletic move of the body weight from our body, it's actually doing something in a direction rather than controlling as a club,
right.
Putting the energy into
exactly.
The club. We're performance based in the sense of doing something.
Exactly. Your feet go places.
Right.
In what you've done for years. In golf, you have to do the same thing without the freedom of using your changing location to do it for you. Yeah. The footwork, so you can see the footwork's critical.
Definitely.
Which is true in your sport as well.
Definitely.
But it's stationary at the same time.
That's been the hardest thing for me in golf, is learning to harness that power versus in football. It's explosive, you're moving. The hardest thing for me has been being able to stand still, transfer weight, and conducively hit it through the ball. And I just can't figure it out, so please help me.
We're going to help you. Greg, get set up and take a practice swing. And one of the things we've talked about, and I have been using my best sermon approach on you, is starting by relaxing your forearms. Because you guys, especially, you're used to using these as tools.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you have to stay relaxed.
Well, that's something I've learned because I've had quite a few lessons, but no one has ever told me about using your forearms tension as a key to you not relaxing. So that is a real good point for me.
Me as an NFL player, when I go to explode into the ball carrier, relaxing is the last thing that I'm thinking about. So I picture that in my mind. I'm going to explode into this ball, and I'm just as tense as I possibly can be.
Well, that's the way we've been trained is that you attack it, and the harder you attack it, the better job you'll do.
In fact, the only guy saying relax is the guy you're chasing, right?
Exactly. He's like, hey, relax.
Okay, let's take a practice swing. And I'm gonna check your forearms to make sure you're not getting tight. And remember the other thing we've been talking about? Don't battle yourself trying to keep your head down.
Okay.
Be relaxed in your shoulders as well, in your neck muscles. Because as soon as you tense up your shoulders, the same thing happens there. Release with, outstanding. That's incredible.
Good coaching.
He's ready for the tour.
Oh, my goodness. Good swing. Okay, one more practice swing, then we're going to have you hit a shot. Good. Okay, get set up to the golf ball. Let me take a look at here, and we're going to hit a shot.
Okay,
I want to check forearms. Now, again, stay there, because one of the problems, and just thinking about this, because you guys are the people... Everyone comes, they come out from everywhere to watch.
Mm-hmm.
Even when you're on the golf course, they want to see you. NFL careers, these are the guys. I want to go see them. And the bad news for you is on the football field, that's okay. Because
that's our element.
That's you.
We're comfortable.
You want them to come out and watch that because that's your game. On the golf course, that causes some tension.
A lot of stress.
So you're standing over the golf ball and every eye is on you. And what happens? I get just a little tight right here. And we talked about when you're in your stance, just let your arms hang. That's the tension you should have in your golf swing, in your arms. That's a challenge. So go ahead. That's the challenge I'm giving you right now.
A definite challenge for a linebacker who's agile, mobile, and hostile on the field to be able to come and pray. You know, when I approach the ball, I'm thinking my adrenaline starts to flow because I want to succeed. I want to win. But I'm not playing against somebody I can tackle. I'm playing against a little round white ball down here. This is not really going anywhere unless I do it.
This is really a process of renewing your mind of something totally different.
Mm. And the thing is, you can't renew your mind with your mind.
That is true.
It has to be something fresh.
That's right.
Okay, Greg, one more. And then we're
going. I like that shot.
That was good.
I was impressed.
That was good.
I like that.
I think you're ready for the
tour. It feels good to hit us.
Yeah, but don't get too excited when a 25 handicapper says he was impressed. Let's take this in stages.
But you got to understand, if you get it straight,
that's right. It works.
That is
nice
exciting.
And relaxed, and just relaxed all
see
the way through. Start and
thing.
Finish relaxed. Let the weight, excellent, strong. A little right to left on it. Okay, let's switch spots.
Wow, that's impressive.
Let's switch
Thank
spots.
Thank you, Derwin. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
I'll take all compliments I can get.
Hopefully, after this, you and I'll be ready for the tour.
It's possible. My wife may have something to say.
I want to see a practice swing. I want to see a practice swing. Good. One more time. Okay, now.
I noticed something I was doing wrong from previous.
Okay.
I was taking it back here instead of in one piece.
Well, see, you know, watching you on the football field, I understand that because you're running down the field like this with the guy's shirt. Right? But is that you?
That's not for anybody to see. That's just
see, that's why you're so good at it and your hands are so effective.
And it takes many years of practice of deceiving the referees because these guys run too fast.
Now, Darryl, we know you don't do that.
I don't do that.
So, here's what we have to do. Go ahead and get set up for the golf ball.
It's those offensive linemen that do that.
And receivers that do that.
And what I'm going to show you something. Okay, you get in your stance.
Okay.
What I'm going to do is I want you to start your swing with your shoulders.
Okay.
Go ahead and try to start the club. Feel that move?
Mm-hmm.
Because what you're doing is now you're starting to make your turn, and that should start your swing. What you're doing is, again, because you're so active with your hands and what you do, go ahead and take your grip. I'll show you. You're firing from
like
here.
Like that. Mm-hmm.
That's a very inconsistent move, and it causes a lot of problems. So if we don't have to do that, let's just go ahead and get rid of it.
Okay, I'm feeling it now.
Should that concern me? Nice and relaxed. Okay. The one thing that we really have got to emphasize in your swing is relax. You don't have to be in a hurry.
Okay.
Again, we talked about swinging at 80 or 85%. And that's a good drill for you. Nice and relaxed, weight shift, athletic move, excellent. Much better. The one thing you don't want to do, you don't want to get trapped into evaluating everything when you're working on something with golf ball results and flight. You don't want to judge yourself by what's happening there. Because when you're working on something, you're developing it. And it's not going to happen instantly. And the problem for just about everyone I work with is fix my swing and fix it now.
Mm-hmm. Instant.
Exactly.
Well, I can feel a difference from when I hit it not doing like you taught and doing it the way you taught. I can feel a difference, a shift.
Right.
And I can feel the club striking the ball better.
Good.
Now see if I can get one straight.
That was a good swing. That was a very good swing.
Looky here.
That's what I'm talking
Looky
about.
Looky here.
Get in the hole. Get in the hole.
All right, all righty
nice ball.
Then.
Very nice. But already you can feel what you're supposed to do. You can compare the two.
Definitely.
That's always our goal, is to get you to understand what you have to do. Instead of me being in a position where I have to say, every swing, do this, do this, do this. What we want to do is set you free with something that you can go work on and improve.
So what we hear you saying, you don't want to play every round of golf with us.
Yes, exactly.
Point.
Okay, still a little quick. That time, that time what we noticed again, go ahead and, because this is a tough, a really tough habit to break, as we've talked about, doing too much with the hands. Because everything we do with our hands. We drive, we pick up, everything we rearrange in our life, we do it with our hands. So as soon as I put a golf club in your hands, what are your hands gonna do? All the work. And what we have to do is make sure that we get the turn taking control, and then let the hands do what they're supposed to. But they can't dictate what's happening.
Gotcha.
Good, good setup. Athletic move, just nice and relaxed. There it is.
Nice.
That feels so much better.
It looks really good too. You see the difference in the fluid motion.
Just he's just slowing down that.
It's nice and relaxed. It's not forced, and he's getting in a very good position.
Excellent.
There's only one thing worse than being on a golf course and hitting a bad shot and not knowing what went wrong. That's hitting a good shot not knowing how you did it.
You did it.
That's me.
And what we want to do is every time you make a swing, we want you to have a thought that, okay, this is what I'm trying to get done. That creates improvement because you're making your swing better. All of the focus you put on your golf ball has no value because that ball is disconnected from you. The only thing that has value is what you're doing in your swing.
Gotcha.
Then you can dictate what the ball does. But you're standing there, oh gee, I hope it doesn't go in the water, I hope I don't hit it in the woods, I hope I don't top it.
Right.
That's wasted thought. That accomplishes nothing.
One of the, and what we're talking about is basically fundamentals.
Oh, certainly.
I mean, for me, I think one of the big things is just simply relaxing, because as in playing professional football, I'm just, I'm constantly in a knot, ready to explode on something.
Right.
Where, and I think this is, the relaxing the forearms is a fundamental, I mean.
Well, and we talked about it. You're not gonna get in the NFL unless you started with the foundation, the basics.
Right. Right.
That's what you develop off of. But if you think about it, most people start golf later in life. They go out and buy a set of golf clubs and they go pay the greens fees and they play golf. And they're trying to figure it out on their own with no foundation.
Right.
It doesn't work.
Exactly.
It doesn't work. There we go. Still a little too much effort, but better.
Yeah.
Okay?
All right.
Great, guys. What we're going to do is we're going to keep working on the swing a little bit, and we want you to come back in just a minute, and we're going to get to know these guys personally, see what they have to say to us. Okay?
This Celebrity Golf Series is brought to you in part by CGA. Get involved with the CGA Youth Instructional League program in your community. Contact your local CGA chapter or CGA National on the web at www.cga.org.
Welcome back. I've asked Greg and Derwin to sit down with us so we can talk a little bit and get to know them just a little bit better. Greg, first with you, football career, Atlanta Falcons, linebacker.
12 years.
12 years.
12 years. That was in before free agency, so I played all of my ball with the Atlanta Falcons.
That's pretty unique now, isn't it?
Well, yeah. Well, it's
a couple of unique things there. One is not only with one team, but the length of that.
Well, usually your average life of a professional football player is like four and a half years. And I was fortunate, blessed, to play with one team 12 years. I started my rookie year season. In fact, I started every season with the Falcons.
Derwin with the Panthers?
Yeah, actually.
Started with the Colts, though, right?
Right. I was drafted with the Colts in 1993, the fourth round. Played there for five seasons. Played last season with the Carolina Panthers. And I'll be going into my seventh season next year.
I was reading some of the accomplishments for both of you. It's pretty impressive. You guys know how to play. And that's kind
of
neat.
Well, I think whenever you get to the professional level, you look at everybody's credentials and they're pretty.
Well, yeah, you think about how many thousands of guys are getting pumped out from major college football programs every year. And to think, I mean, 12 years and how many years now and still going for you. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's tough. That is really tough.
It is a tremendous blessing because everyone is so talented that it's really the sovereignty of God and a lot of hard work, dedication, and just really being blessed to be in the right place at the right time.
Derwin, let me ask you this. People look at you, say the football career, star, everyone says, oh, that's the life, that's what I want. What could God possibly add to that that you even needed him?
Fulfillment. Growing up, my entire focus in life, my essence, my being was to make it to the NFL. I can remember being a little boy just watching all the big NFL players play and saying, I want to be there one day. And when I made it, it was like, is this it? Is this all that I've worked so hard to accomplish? And is this the most satisfaction that I can get out of it? And what Jesus Christ has done in my life is that he's filled that void that was in my heart. Mm. And we're all created with a void and hole in our heart that only Jesus Christ can fill. I've been in a locker room for a lot of years, and I've seen a lot of guys that are very wealthy, wine, women, song, and dance. And they have that, but yet and still, they don't have peace nor happiness. And the Bible says that blessed are those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. And truly, 3 years in the NFL of having money, having cars, a beautiful wife, a family, the only thing that has truly brought me satisfaction is having a relationship with Jesus Christ. And that has put everything together and in perspective.
I know that just has to be hard for people to hear and understand, because on the outside looking in, it doesn't make sense, does it? Mm-hmm. But until you've lived it, it doesn't connect that well. And that's one of the things I've heard you speak, and I know you're trying to share, is just to get people to maybe question, to take a look at themselves. And it's, I mean, you've done an outstanding job. I heard you speak after the golf outing the other night. You know, we're here with the Week of Champions. Both of you guys have come in, work with kids all week, play golf, have some fun, but you get to teach the kids your skills, and the neat thing about that is you also get to share Christ with them.
Definitely. Most importantly, football is secondary. The first thing that we want to do is get them to get here with the various golf and soccer and football, but the most important message is Jesus Christ, period, point blank. And every drill that I do, I make it a life instance of where they can apply Christ to it, as well as on the field. And being an outsider or not knowing Jesus for 24 years of my life and looking at people that were Christians, you know, I thought it was a little different of how they lived their lives and how they did things opposite of the world, and I thought that was strange. You know, sometimes I talked to people that were Christian and they'd say, well, you know, money's not my focus or my position in life is not my focus. My focus and position is Jesus Christ. And now that I'm a Christian, I truly understand that. Because being a football player is not who I am. That's only a part of what I do. Who I am is Jesus Christ. I want him and his light to shine within me. Mm-hmm. And everything that I do is to glorify him. People ask me, well, why do you play? Before I became Christian, it was to get money to win Super Bowls. The reason I play now is so I can do shows like this and proclaim the name of Jesus Christ.
We appreciate that. Greg, for you, you're in a different position. You are where Derwin's going. Out of football, you've moved on with life. What was that transition like for you? Because again, the way people see you, it's life had to be over for you.
and you know, it is for a lot of players. I'm in marriage and family counseling now, and I even now I see players who their life is football, as Derwin talked about his life initially being football and Super Bowls. And even though that they play 10 or 12 years in ball and they get out, their life is basically over. For me, it was an excellent transition. I'm not saying that I don't miss ball, and I don't say I don't miss the money that playing ball brings in. But the transition was that I had my faith in Christ, knowing that he had another phase of life for me to enter. And I think it's when a player has his life in a professional sport, even a golfer or a baseball player, or whatever. If their life is in their sport, then their career ends. Even for a duffer, you know, a golfer who hacks at it all the time, and his life is in golf, and then all of a sudden he dislocates a shoulder, or eyesight begins to dim, or something happens where it's taken away from him,
right.
Then the depression sets in.
Right.
And what kept me from depression was my hope that Christ is my life and that he has just another phase of life for me to enter. And it's exactly the way it happened.
You talk about an act of God. Think about this. An NFL linebacker is now doing what?
A marriage and family counselor.
Explain now, that to me.
You know, the vision that I see of a linebacker and knowing his career of being all prone to things that he's done, he's smashed people and caused fumbles and knocked helmets out and knocked people out. Now Christ has changed his heart where he can talk about things of love and helping people become one flesh, as the Bible says. Now that's the power of God.
That's exciting.
When he changes your
heart. Well, someone has done a psychological survey of the San Diego Chargers one year. A psychologist or a psychiatrist did a study on position, NFL position, like offensive tackles are fairly neat and passive individuals most of the time, and defensive tackles are messy and they hate you before you even get on the field. I've seen this in locker rooms. You go around to offensive locker rooms, they're neat, straight, and orderly, and defensive locker rooms, it's full of trash, and they just throw the things in.
That's mine.
And quarterbacks are kind of prima donnas, and defensive backs are usually paranoid. They get blamed for all the, it's not my fault,
about?
You know.
And, what, who, me? What, me?
And linebackers, they say they could make good hitmen for the mafia. They come, stick you, and walk away, smile. And as Derwin said, you know, I used to have tremendous anger. In fact, one of the reasons that I'm in marriage and family counseling is because my wife said to me back in 1971 that she had had enough of living with me. She was leaving me. And I said, "Had up, baby, I got enough headaches of my own, don't need you." Well, it was 2 weeks later that I came to Christ. Mm. And I came home and told her. We were playing the Rams when the Rams were on the West Coast. We had a chapel service, and a man shared that if I would turn from my sin and trust Christ, that he would create in me a new creation. And I believed him. Mm-hmm. And I got home, and I told Connie that I've given my life to Christ, and she said, "Good, you need it." But it was through God working out all of our marital problems that other people come and started asking us, "Hey, my marriage is where yours used to be. Could I talk to you?" It's kind of like you working with our problems in our golf, just telling me to relax and get the fundamentals straight. I'm doing the same thing with marriages and families.
Oh, because, trust me, my job's a little tougher.
Because God has done it with my marriage.
Exactly. Exactly. That's you shared that, I mean, very quickly there, but I mean, I'm sure a lot of people are thinking when you say how you went to chapel and it was like it happened that easily. Is it? Can it happen?
Well,
is it that simple? Is it? Can you do it?
Well, what happened was a teammate of mine. You know, there's usually a chapel leader on the team, and the rumor was you'll never get that other linebacker. There was Hanson and Nobis and Brezina, and I was the other line. You never get that other linebacker in the chapel. I don't know why I went, maybe for God to bless my play. My playing wasn't that great because I was drinking, getting drunk 3 times a week, and I was just miserable because I'd achieved all the goals that I set myself. The year before I played in the Pro Bowl, I'd set all the goals that I achieved for myself personally, and there wasn't anything there. So I said, just to heck with everything. And it was at that point that I went to chapel, and the guy gave the message, you know, if God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life, and I thought and said, well, if God's out there. And he said, the reason you don't know God's love is because basically you're sinful and separated from God. And I said, wait a minute, I heard that growing up. Mom took me to church. Do good, you're going to heaven. Do bad, you're going to hell. And I didn't see anybody do enough good to make it. I sure couldn't do enough good. And he went on to say that, you know, no one has to tell you you're a sinner. How do you feel when you do wrong? Your conscience, you feel bad. Your conscience. And when you do right, you feel good. No one has to tell me that I'm a sinner. And then he went on to say, that's why Jesus Christ, God incarnate, born of a virgin, lived a perfect life, willingly gave his life on a cross so he could take my sin. Mm-hmm. And he said, it's not enough to know those. I knew them. I sat in a pew going up.
Right.
He said, it's not enough. Hmm. It's not enough to know those things. You must come to a point where you actually believe it, you receive it.
Good.
And I went up to my hotel room and started thinking about all my life, how all my life I set goals to achieve goals. And I just came to the point, God, if you're out there, if Jesus Christ is who this man says you are, come into my life and show me my sins are forgiven. Well, it wasn't so much my arrogant words. They really weren't arrogant. They were humble. Mm-hmm. God knew that I wanted my sins forgiven. He knew I wanted them.
And it happened.
Well, and I don't know if anybody can describe how it happened.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But all of a sudden, I knew the guilt of my sin was taken off of me. I had the guilt of this golf course on top of me, carrying around. But all of a sudden, it was lifted off to me. So when I came home and told Connie that I received Christ, I could see her response because of all the stuff I dumped on her the years before.
Mm. Wow.
But I had a hunger in my heart.
That's
I had a
great.
Hunger for the first time to read the Bible.
That's great. Yeah. Derwin, tell me about Christ in your life today in relationship to your career and your family. What does that mean to you?
Okay. The Bible says for the man to be the head of the family is Christ is the head of the church. And the most important thing that I can give my family is to be an example and an ambassador for Jesus Christ and exhibit that love to my wife and daughter and my extended family as well. You know, when I first got married, I thought I loved my wife. But until I accepted Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of love, then I could truly love her because he had showed me his love. And my whole focus and emphasis on life now is to glorify him in all that I do, period, whether if it's on the NFL field, whether if it's in the workplace when I'm doing internships, or no matter where it's at. And that's what my focus and priority is, where it was before Christ, it was all selfishness, me, I, what can I do? I need my time. Versus now, as the Bible says, that Christ humbled himself and became a bond servant. And now I take pleasure in serving my family and showing love versus always trying to serve me. Versus when I first got in the NFL, it was just all about winning, losing money.
Right.
Now it's all about Christ. And the way that I came to Christ was my rookie year in the locker room for the Colts. There was a linebacker on the team by the name of Stephen Grant, who was an ordained minister, and we called him the naked preacher. Because every day after practice, he'd go in the shower, he'd go in the shower, come out, dry off, and put on a towel and walk around to everybody's locker with a Bible asking them, did they know Jesus Christ personally? And up until that point, I'd never heard the gospel shared.
That's the naked preacher.
And so the naked preacher came to me one day and said, do you know Jesus? And I said, well, I'm a good person. He said, I didn't ask you that. Do you know Jesus? Then he explained to me that we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God and that we need to be reconciled back to God the Father through Jesus Christ and accepting him as your Savior. It took me 3 years. He chased me around the locker room for 3 years. And in 1995, on an away game to play the Oakland Raiders, I accepted Christ into my heart. We went down to the swimming pool and he baptized me right there. But I distinctly remember in 1997 in training camp where the Lord just put it upon my heart to really hunger and thirst and seek him and love him with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. I could remember calling my wife and saying, this is what I want to do. I want to exemplify Christ to you, my family, everything that I want to do. And I knew that. I think in 1995,